Hello, hackers.
Let's talk about mitigations in the Linux kernel. Of course, you have already hit the ground running. You are exploiting the kernel, but you're running into situations where, shit, you can't execute shellcode or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Why? Because mitigations. Why do we need them? Well, the kernel is a very popular and very high value target. Kernel exploits are extremely important because they are usable in situations where you might otherwise have limited control. So for example, kernel exploits are very typically present inside as part of a typical exploit chain to take over a mobile phone, for example. And in a kind of more pedestrian way, they're present in a lot of, you know, general purpose computing device exploits to elevate privileges and all the stuff that you've been doing so far. So it's a popular target and it gets attacked often. A lot of bugs get found in the Linux kernel and in other kernels. they don't all even get tracked as CVEs for various reasons, from shady to non-shady. But even just as tracked by CVEs in 2021 alone, there have been 149 vulnerabilities in the Linux kernel. So of course, the kernel will get attacked. So what do we do about that, right? Obviously, ideally, we can have a non-attackable kernel, but that's not the case. We're not there yet. We're not going to be there for a very long time. So what we do is mitigations, right? Similar to the user space case where you have now explored tons and tons and tons and tons of different styles of mitigations, we have the same thing in the kernel world. Basically, kernel developers say, okay, we're not going to be able to prevent all the vulnerabilities. It's just not impossible. It's just not possible, right? So let's make it hard for attackers to actually achieve control, to actually do significant damage, even if they find a bug. And most of these mitigations look very familiar, right? The kernel has stack canaries. The kernel has ASLR, where at boot, it'll place the kernel at a random location. The kernel has NX, right? In a similar way to your user space experience of running into these mitigations as well. If you're interested in kind of the kernel's security posture philosophy, take a look at this link. It's an interesting read. And actually, the kernel documentation in general is pretty good if you're interested in kernel security. But the TLDR is that the kernel has a lot of various mitigations. But of course, you have spent much of this class bypassing mitigations. So you've bypassed stack canaries by leaking them or jumping over them or doing a number of other exotic things. You've bypassed ASLR in user space by leaking library-based addresses, program-based addresses, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You leak a pointer, you bypass ASLR. And it's the same in the kernel. You leak a kernel pointer, you can figure out where the kernel is based. And from there, you can figure out where whatever functions you want to call, whatever gadgets you want to call, exist. Speaking of gadgets, of course, you have trouble executing shellcode in the kernel most of the time because most data regions are non-executable in the kernel. But of course, you'll also know how to bypass that, for example, with return-oriented programming. So the kernel, of course, has this cat and mouse game, et cetera, et cetera. One crazy solution that's upcoming, not really widely deployed right now, is this concept of function granular KASLR. The idea is, aside from just loading the kernel at a specific address, you also have all of the functions in the kernel shuffled around, right? It's an interesting upcoming mitigation that will prevent you bypassing KASLR just by leaking an address. But there's still a lot of things you find out from leaking an address. In practice, function granular ASLR is not the full solution. You can read more about the concept in this article that's linked here of the, if I remember correctly, I linked here the proposed patch, for example. But Kind of a this partial solution. There will be KG or sorry FGKASLR bypasses. It's just another volley in this war. There is also some very, very kernel specific mitigations because the kernel has a very special security posture, right? Because it lives kind of on top or under all of the user land and so forth, nestled in ring zero. The way that many exploits work when they're attacking the kernel is they trick the kernel into accessing or executing memory that's actually in user space, right? And there are two mitigations that were created to prevent this from happening. One of them is called SMEP, Supervisor Memory Execution Protection. It prevents kernel code from jumping to user space code, right? As you've been exploiting the kernel, you might think, oh, if I overflow the return address here, I can just have it return into my shell code in my user space application. That is no longer the case. It used to be the case for a long time, but SMEP came out in the last, I should have looked this up when SMEP came out, but like, let's say in the last 5 years it got very popular, maybe 8 years. SMEP came out and it prevents kernel code from jumping to user space without going through the correct, you know, return from a syscall, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Right? So that is closed one exploitation vector, let's say, of the Linux kernel. Then there's a second problem of exploits fooling the kernel into accessing user space memory improperly, right? And another technique was proposed to protect that, supervisor memory access protection or prevention. Anyways, SMAP prevents kernel space from accessing memory that's in user space unless a flag in the rflags register is set. Now, of course, you can set the rflags register using the stac command in your exploit, but that already, at that point, you already have execution. You probably don't need to access user space memory, right? But what it does prevent is, let's say, an uncareful handling of a structure that's passed through an ioctl containing a user space pointer, causing the kernel to go directly into that, into user space. Now, why is SMEP and SMAP separated? Why can't you say, you know what, screw it, you just, user space doesn't exist when you're in the kernel? Well, that's not realistic. You need to be able to pass in arguments through system calls. For example, the path arguments to open, or the various, you know, small structs to other syscalls. And so the kernel needs to be able to access memory in user space, but it does that by using specific APIs to do that, such as copy from user and copy to user, which sets the right flag, the AC flag in the RFlags register, does the access, and then clears it again. Simple mitigation, big protection. Now, in all of the challenges in these modules, SMEP and SMAP are both on. Why? Because it's 2021. We're not going to insult your intelligence by having you exploit things that do not exist as problems in real modern deployments anymore. Of course, there are legacy systems that don't have these protections. But in this module, we're assuming that at least these protections exist. KASLR, kind of hit and miss in this module. Some of our challenges have it on, some of them have it off. But SMAP and SMAP are all on. But of course, all of these mitigations, kernel exploitation, like all exploitation, is a martial art. It's a slow battle between attackers and defenders. There's blocking, there's striking. It's all very exciting. And new techniques are developed all the time, both on the offensive and the defensive side. On the offensive side, one response to SMEP, for example, is the use of the run command function in the Linux kernel. Run command in the Linux kernel just takes a string, splits it by spaces, and runs it as root in user space. Right? Obviously, that's a very powerful primitive. It's a kernel function. So if you have kernel code execution, and you can call a function with a controlled argument, boom, run command is your friend. You don't have to return to user space. You don't have to do a lot of things. You can just run a command as root. If you're interested in how that actually works under the hood, you can look up the source code on Bootlin. It's an awesome resource for looking up kernel concepts. That's a link to the latest version. I think the version that we're running in pwn College right now is 5.4, but it's very analogous, right? And you can actually change Bootlin to look at the correct version that you're interested in. So this is just one kind of bypass. I mean, it's very cheap as a bypass. It just, you know, runs commands, but it's quite viable. So all of these exploits that used to have to jump back into user space code or do complex wrap could just potentially call run CMD. Obviously, there are other advanced kernel exploitation techniques, but for the most part, for this module, you are really mastering the basics to be able to operate in the kernel successfully.